You are now listening to Vigilantes Radio, presented by the Only One Media Group. This is the people's choice for quality interviews, celebrities, and special guests. Hosted by Demetrius Dinny Reynolds. Call in to join the mix at 701-801-9813. For the complete archive of episodes, visit onlyonemediagroup.com and be sure to like us on Facebook at Vigilantes Radio. We welcome all. Enjoy the show. Ladies and gentlemen, please welcome your host, Demetrius whodini-blak Reynolds. Enjoy the show.
Well, 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 here we are again, guys. Welcome to another incredible episode of Vigilantes Radio Live right here on iHeartRadio. And I am your host, Dini. Hope you guys are having a fantastic morning. We have a very special guest for you guys, so you definitely want to stick around for that. And as a matter of fact, text your buddies, family members, or even share it on social media right now and let them know that we are about to dive deep into another interview. Before I bring my guest on, I want to say that, you know, when you disagree with someone, one of the best things you can do is listen, you know. It sounds so simple, but Man, you know, this is America, right? How many opinions do we have? How many people have something to say? But I feel like, you know, we can really get somewhere if we just listen, you know, instead of lecturing all the time, just listen. Rather than arguing, listen and seek to understand. It's natural to want to explain your point of view, and the best way to equip yourself to do that is to understand that, the other person's point of view. You can listen respectfully and still disagree. You can understand completely and still not give in. But when you do listen, you make an effort to understand, you improve the situation almost immediately. When you win an argument, you have won nothing except the other person's resentment. When you resolve the argument through genuine mutual understanding, even though you may continue to disagree, you have earned respect and cooperation. And that way, everyone wins something of real value. Even disagreements can be a way to move positively forward. You know, when you have the strength and the confidence to truly listen and truly understand. Take that from me, Coach Dini. That is my word, and word is bond.
Have you struggled budgeting your finances? Don't worry, you're not alone. Humbledbudget.com, that's HumbledBudget.com, is the help and resource you've been searching for. Humbledbudget.com is a personal finance and educational website with a great variety of topics when it comes to budgeting, taxes, investing, and the popular topic of FIRE, financial independence, retire early. Humbledbudget.com has a goal, and that's to help you reach your financial dreams, no matter what your goals are when it comes to finances. It doesn't matter where you start, where you come from, or where you are right now. HumbledBudget.com can help. What are you waiting for? Take that first step to the financial life you've dreamed of and go to HumbledBudget.com. That's HumbledBudget. HumbledBudget.com.
All right, again, welcome to the show. You're listening to VRL, that's Vigilantes Radio Live, right here on iHeartRadio, and I am your host, Dini. Our interviews are designed to go beyond music, news, books, art, acting, films, technology, education, entrepreneurship, entertainment, and sometimes even a thing that we call the ego. Our interviews are designed to go behind the scenes of these incredible human beings, you know, the ones who are out there giving it their all for me, for you, and for the world. Well, guys, if you've been following my work, you know who our next guest is. We're about to step into the world of the phenomenal Drew Hoagland, where the charm of Maine meets the pulse of YouTube, right? From the snowy trails of his beloved state to the heart of his political scene, Drew's journey is as diverse as it is captivating. You know, he was homeschooled, He's a traveler, skier. I didn't know that. Cool, that's real cool. And now a digital storyteller. He brings a unique blend of personal experiences and insightful observations to his growing YouTube audience. You know, whether that's discussing state politics or exploring Maine's natural beauty. Drew's authenticity and passion shines through. So join us. Grab your coffee, your cup of joe, your cup of tea, whatever it is. If it's alcohol, hey, that's your choice. But grab whatever it is and join us as we unravel the tales of this proud Maine native and his journey from personal discovery to public discourse. And with that, let's welcome Drew to the show. All right. Well, Drew, again, man, welcome to the show. It's great to have you with us. Yeah, you missed my phenomenal introduction of you.
It's all good. I'll have to go back and listen.
Yeah. But in the intro, I mentioned that you were a skier, and I did not know that. So we'll talk about it a little bit later. But yeah, man, it's great to have you with us. As a Maine native with such a varied background, what sparked your interest in creating a YouTube channel focused on Maine's news and political landscape?
A lot of it had to do with the fact that I didn't see anyone else doing it online. When I watch a lot of YouTube, I listen to a lot of commentary and podcasts. So when I would go to look for Maine political commentary of any sort, just to know what's going on in my own state, there was such a lack. So it was because of that lack that I realized that someone should pick up the slack. And as I started looking into what I might cover, the ballot was an obvious first topic. And then I realized there was so much literal propaganda just being spent at the millions of dollar range to get Mainers to think the particular way that our electric company wanted us to think. And unfortunately, it did pass, but it was a good conversation to begin, and now we can carry it forward. And I'm hoping that by being an active participant on YouTube now, that I can get a following to maybe make an impact in the future.
Yeah. Do you think that you'll move into the political space as an individual?
I think somewhat. It was always inevitable. One of my favorite classes in high school was American government and law, and I thrived at it. It was surprising. It wasn't something that I expected. And
wow.
I got out of it in my 20s. I traveled. I paid no attention to the political scheme. And then it wasn't until my late 20s that I started getting back involved, started paying attention. I was paying attention to the wrong sources at the time, so I do think that my mindset has changed since the beginning of my political experience, but it's been a good journey. I've been registered as an independent, a Republican, a Democrat. I've kind of tasted the waters of all of them just to see what I liked, what I didn't like, and ultimately, I wish it didn't come down to party lines, because so many people I talk to, they're not Republicans, they're not Democrats. Independent doesn't quite fit them. So it just seems like there's a bunch lacking. And because I'm centered on Maine, I love this state. I've seen 48 of the 50 states. Alaska and Hawaii are the only two I haven't been to. And
wow.
Yeah. I traveled in my 20s, but while I was traveling, I was working, whitewater rafting as a guide, serving, customer service, whatever I had to do. So then I came back to Maine, and I fell in love with the place that I was born. I didn't realize how good it was here until I left and came back. And now that I'm back, I'm seeing a lot of destruction on the things that make this place precious. And if no one else is going to step up and protect this place, then I might as well.
Man, that is awesome. And I'm learning so much about you. Like, you're really multidimensional, man.
Yeah.
48 states. That's cool. That's real cool.
Yeah. I didn't spend significant time in all of them, but at least more than just touching down in an airport, driving through, going to gas stations and whatnot.
Yeah. Man, you know, also what I think is incredible is that you tested the water of all of these political parties. You know, usually I hear that people will kind of comb through what each thing stands for, and then they pick one, and then that's it. They don't see the other side, the other view, the living conditions, or, you know, the narrative driven from these political parties. But you tested the water of most political parties, and a lot of people don't do that. So
it was really beneficial, I think.
Yeah. So where do you stand now?
That's a good question. So currently, I am a registered Republican.
Okay.
That's because I want to be able to vote in the Republican primary, because at this point, I have given up on the Democratic Party.
Mm-hmm.
They used to be the party of the people. And I'm a blue-collar worker. Like, I get up at 4:30 in the morning to go work with steel and metal and work around all these other guys that are doing the same thing. And there are women. And we're all blue-collar workers. And it no longer feels like the Democratic Party has our best interest in mind. So it's almost like I'm Republican because I don't want to be Democrat. But I still want to have a voice when it comes to the primaries.
Yes, indeed. Is Maine a red state?
We're purple. Like, we're pretty famously purple. Yeah, because we've gone both ways. So that is something I appreciate. It does kind of stink because Portland is our largest city. It's nowhere near New York City's size. But if you imagine New York City dwarfs the rest of New York State.
Mm.
So the rest of New York State has to have laws because of New York City. And so it's kind of like that with Portland. Like, Portland has a certain way that they like to live, and there's a lot of population down there. And then because of that, they can sway the state. And so if the rural areas in Maine, which are the vast majority, if we don't get in the same mindset, then our blue Portland will definitely sway us. Sometimes that's an okay thing. Sometimes Maine is for that. Sometimes we're not about it. But because of the weight down there being thrown around, it's hard to compete now, currently, like it hasn't been in the past.
I get that. All this month, we've been talking about doing something new. This year, I parasailed in Florida.
Nice.
Yeah.
How was that?
It was fun, except for the jellyfish. You know, when your feet touch the water, you can see the jellyfish trying to sting you.
Did you get
stung? No. No, incredibly, I didn't. But, yeah, you can see them. They're waiting for my heels to hit the water so they can touch it. But it was so beautiful, man. It was so beautiful seeing all that. Dolphins and all that, man. Just swimming underneath you while you're in the sky.
Were you nervous at all?
Yeah. So I have man feet, right? So the dude's like, take your socks off. I'm like, what? That was the only part that I was terrified, you know, showing my feet. So, but since that day, I've transformed them almost 360 to like brand new feet. Almost. They're almost there.
Nice.
So I guess I needed that experience.
Showing them off all there.
Yeah, I needed that experience, man.
Yeah.
So have you tried anything new this year?
Well, I guess YouTube would be the first thing to mind, because that's something that I have actually tossed around for at least a year before I started it. So YouTube for me is new as of 3 weeks ago. So it wasn't this month technically, but this year YouTube was definitely something new. I used to work retail for a little while, framing artwork, and it was fun. but I hated the, well, okay. Anyway, I worked around a lot of Gen Zers, and they would come in and they would just kind of shoot the shit with me, and they would pose a question, and then I would give them just honest, direct, sometimes brutal feedback. And sometimes they would, at first they were like, but then they'd always come back, and then they started complaining less, and then they started listening more, and then they would tell me like, hey, you should have a YouTube, like, you talk about some good things, and I'd listen to that. But first I was just like, okay, yeah, but then as this year's gone on, I realized, okay, there does seem to be this void, at least here in Maine, that could be filled. And I'm not looking for a huge audience. I just would like people that resonate with it within my own state or wherever they are in the world to be able to find someone else that's like-minded and kind of thinking the same thing when they think no one else is.
Absolutely, man. So you mentioned that you traveled in your early 20s, 48 states, impressive, impressive. How does these experiences influence your perspective on Maine and its community?
I realize that we have it so well here in Maine. One of the mottos of Maine is the way life should be. And I really see that as being true. Because, I mean, Maine used to be accused of being a white state, which is still true. We are having heavy immigration, which is great. Like, people coming here to work, that has always been great. And we have always been very accepting. It's just our cold weather drives many people away. And so if you can get used to the weather, then you'll find so much beauty in this state. And there is lots of room for people that want to work. And so it's been a really nice experience to just come back and see things that people had once complained about are now changing. And then the fact that we have so much to offer. Coast, mountains, just farmland. We are bordering Canada, so if you want to get there, you can get there right away. So Maine, to me, is just a very idyllic place. Another, our slogan is vacation land, and it's very much true. There's, like, I don't know the exact count of how many people come through Maine a year, but we have such heavy tourism because we have such illustrious beauty here and wildlife, some wild, empty wilderness that's untouched. So it's pretty rare. So we have a lot of rarities here in Maine. We have a lot of special things, and more people are starting to learn that, and that's great. But if we don't protect what's always made it great, then it won't be there for future generations to enjoy.
Wow. All right, man. So how has your identity as a gay individual and your background in a Christian household shaped your approach to discussing diverse topics on your channel?
I think because I was also homeschooled in high school, so I think because I had such a non-traditional upbringing that it naturally occurred. Because from a young age, I think other people knew I was gay long before I knew I was gay. You know, when you're a kid, you don't know about sexual anything, but to those that know what to look for, you can see certain behaviors in young gay individuals before they know what that even means. So it wasn't until about junior high that I started figuring it out, but my older siblings already knew, and they're 10, 12, and 13 years older than me. So they could already kind of tell, and so could other people. And so that kind of ostracized me from people around me, because in junior high especially, guys could kind of tell, so they were distant from me. And my parents, being Christian, were very strict about how and when I hung out with women or girls, so that made it tough. So I didn't have a lot of time to hang out with people my age at that time. I was volunteering. I was a Boy Scout. I am an Eagle Scout now.
Nice.
But so I was hanging out with older people, helping them and learning a lot from them. But then in my free time, that's when I spent a lot of time reading and just learning. Especially being homeschooled, I was learning on my own, at my own pace. I could go out into the woods and read history books out there for 3 hours, and it was perfectly fine. So because of all these weird things, I don't know, they're not weird, but at the time, being gay, Christian, homeschooled, it was not it's weird. So because of that, it made me a little bit weird. But then in my 20s, that's when I was like, okay, I need to get out of Maine. I need to try new things, and I need to see for myself. So that's what I did. And that's when I embraced being gay. I walked away from Christianity for a while, and I said I was never coming back to Maine. Like, I didn't want to come back here. I was done with the cold. I wanted heat and summer. So for a couple years, I traveled between Tennessee and Las Vegas. I would spend the summer in Tennessee, winter in Las Vegas, and I did that for 3 years. And then eventually, I realized that the cold wasn't so bad, and I made my way back to Maine. And then I started skiing. And when I started skiing, I started having a new passion for the cold. And then I started to enjoy Maine and its beauty a lot more. The thing with cold is you have to layer, and you have to layer properly. But there are some really incredible alpaca layers, merino wool layerings, and they're thin, they're sweat wicking. So you put them on and they're light. They are more expensive, but you put them on and then it fits nicely, and then you can go out into the cold and it's almost like you're out. I don't know. You're bulky, so it's not like in the summer. I don't know how to describe it, but with the right layers, it's perfect. With the right layers, the cold can be really great.
Hey, man. I did not know that about you, too. especially growing up in a Christian household. I think, you know, junior high, you know, high school is a social, awkward period for a lot of us.
Yeah.
You know, we're trying to find ourselves. You know, you have people who you may be friends with that kind of, you know, discover who they are, and you're like, oh man, this guy know who he is. Me, I have no clue.
Yep.
And I think a lot of us go through that journey. Even when it comes to like religion,
yeah,
you get to a point where you question everything.
Yeah, that's where I was most of my 20s, was just questioning everything. It was just like, okay, well, I was always told this, I was always told that. I need to find out for myself.
Yeah.
And some of it turned out to be completely 100% valid. Some of it turned out to be speculation that with more science and with more time has turned out not to be true. And then other aspects, it was like, okay, this just needed to be explored more and it wasn't understood, but I'm glad to understand it now.
Yeah. So how do you balance like personal storytelling with the broader political and social discussions? I solely believe that personality will outshine and outsell any product, any service, anything.
That's a good question. I guess first off, I don't really think about it. So I've spent most of my jobs have been customer service oriented. Even whitewater rafting as a guide, I would be on the water with complete strangers for 2 hours at a stretch. Sometimes it would be one family. Sometimes the family would be pissed at each other and they'd be quiet and sitting in the boat. Sometimes it'd be strangers of different political beliefs, like two groups or three groups. And then it's my job to get them to be more lighthearted, to just loosen up and then to keep them safe, to give them facts and to keep them entertained as we go down the boat. And when you're doing that four times a day all summer for summers on end, you start to learn about everyone, people from all over. I mentioned to you before, Denny, that some of my favorite rafting people to take on the river were from Louisiana and Mississippi, mm-hmm. because there's just such a vibrancy. Like every time, like no matter the groups, whether it was like Creek and Cajuns, the religious ones, or all the way up north, like didn't matter where from Louisiana or Mississippi you would get them from, they would just have such life to them, and it made my job so much fun. And so those moments were worth living for. But then I learned from the times when the family would not have spent any time together, and then they just road tripped here for 12 hours, and they get out and they're all pissed at each other, and then they get on my boat, and then I'm like, okay, cool, I can tell you guys are furious at each other based on your shoulders, based on the way you're not looking at each other, based on yada yada yada. So customer service has come to me, it's been beaten into me. So because of that customer service aspect, I think it's easier for me to relate to people now, because I have been around so many different people.
Yeah.
On top of 48 different states, I've actually also been to 10 other countries. And so I've literally been around the world and met people from everywhere. And we're all the same. Like, we're all the human race. We all want peace. Very, very few people that I have ever met want war. Very, very few people I have ever met are truly homophobic or truly racist. Mm. Of course they exist. But a lot of times when I had just come out as gay and I went down to Tennessee, and my friends were like, what are you doing? Like, they aren't gonna accept you. And I was like, I wanna be a whitewater rafting guide. And I'm going to do it. If they have a problem with it, they're either going to deal with it or I guess I can leave. But I went down there and they accepted me. They had no problems with me. I was just I was confident in who I was. And then they would start seeing me and they're like, oh, like you're the first gay guy that I've ever really known. And you're not like what I thought. And I would hear that over and over and over again. And I didn't really take it as an insult because they didn't mean it poorly. They just meant they hadn't had any real representation of it. But now that they were okay with it.
Okay. So if you don't mind, let me interject real quick. Because you raise a very important topic. Perception. Yeah. Influences. Beliefs that you don't even have being pushed down to you. I was one of those people that were like, had no experience with any communities except my own. Yep. And of course, race things, because you know, you're in school and there's diversity there, but
yeah.
But personality wise, no experiences. But you had all these ideas pushed down. You know, you had Eminem out at the time, and you know, he's pushing his narrative. You're like, yeah, I stand with that. Yeah. And it wasn't until I too was in customer service. I ended up being like a store manager in retail for like 19 years.
Wow.
And
you'll get experience there.
Yeah, man. Yeah. So I had this opportunity to hire this young man. And in an interview, he's like, I'm gay. I got to say that. And I was like, oh, man, I didn't even know. Why would you say that? He's like, He's like, well, I thought I should let you know up front because, you know, you seem like the bravado type. I'm like, no, I'm a skinny guy. I'm not even in a, I'm not the threatening type. Back then, yeah. I was that skinny, you know. But I was like, why did you say that? Why would you think that of me? And he's like, well, I just thought you needed to know that. I was like, no, let's just do the interview and see how it goes. So while he's telling me that, in my own mind, I'm challenging myself like, did he see through me? You know, is this my chance to redeem myself, my perception of a gay man? And I said, I'm going to hire him just to understand. So I did.
Okay.
And this guy ended up being my best worker. We even still have a relationship to this day.
Nice.
And it was just,
yeah,
it was an experience that I needed so I could understand him.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, and I get that. I've had that so many times. People will be up front and tell me. Sometimes they won't tell me, but I can kind of guess that it's just something new. And especially down south in Tennessee, I loved Tennessee. If anyone calls Tennessee racist, like, they just don't know what they're fucking talking about. So I'll defend Tennessee all day. And I had such a great time down there, and the people were very open and understanding. Sometimes they'd be crusty and on edge, but then after a couple beers and maybe a bowl of this or that, then we'd start just loosening up. They'd start loosening up and then talking, and then it'd be like, oh, I always had this idea, or this idea was mostly pushed because of Hollywood. And again, this was 10 years ago at this point. Mm-hmm. So we're not talking necessarily recently. So this was still like 2012, 2013. And Hollywood still had kind of a pushed narrative of gay guys that, I mean, stereotypes are there, and a lot of gay guys at the time did act like they were being portrayed in Hollywood. So I can't blame anyone for seeing that. But now, I mean, you have lumberjack gays like me, and then you have all kinds of like city gays, you have all kinds of surfer gays. Like, there's just, being gay is the last part of my personality, basically.
Yeah.
Like, I mention it in my videos because I do think it's something that will resonate with certain viewers. And then if it turns certain viewers off, I don't want them watching me anyway. If they want, they can, but I really don't care about them. So it's something that I mention, but ultimately it's a final aspect of my personality. And I think that's what it was always meant to do, the being a normal gay guy. I am kind of offended with the recent LGBTQIA+ movement. I think that we had things better, and now we're pushing and it's gone too far. All I ever wanted as a gay guy was to be a normal American, be able to marry who I want to marry, be able to have homosexuality as the final trait of who I am, and it not bother a single person. Or if it does bother people, then they're just not in my life.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Man, I love that you said that, too. So I listened to your episodes, and I must have missed you saying that, because I had no idea until you mentioned it on Pod Squad.
Huh. Yeah, like I said, it only comes up, I think, maybe in 3 of the videos. I don't think I mention it very often at all. I've mentioned it, I think, during the mass shooting video that I did when it was, the manhunt was still on. And sometimes I will admit, sometimes I use the gay label as armor in certain circumstances, because otherwise I'm this white, straight, white male, perceived straight man. And right now society kind of dunks on individuals in that demographic. So then I feel like being able to say, hey, I am legitimately gay, I have always kind of been looked down upon. Like, when everything was all straight society, I was gay, and I didn't really have a voice then. Now it's LGBT friendly, so I should be able to speak no matter my skin color. And it shouldn't matter anyway, but I do use the gay label as armor in some circumstances, I'll be honest.
Absolutely, man. And that was the thing about our show, is that we wanted to show diversity. We wanted to show inclusion. We're a bunch of Christians, so let's prove it.
Yeah.
Let's prove it. Let's show the world what Christians do. You know, we don't, you're going to hell.
Yeah.
You know, all that. No. We're all brothers and sisters. You know, different colors, different beliefs.
Yeah, we're all the human race.
You have one guy who's a Jehovah Witness. You have one guy who's a Catholic. You have one guy who's on the borderline of being like Satan's apprentice, you know? So
I had so much fun on the show. I've instantly, like right away, just felt connected and felt pretty at ease. And the conversations always flowed smoothly.
I appreciate that, Drew. We really do.
Yeah.
All right. So, okay. What I really wanted to talk about is because I believe you plan on incorporating other voices and stories of Maine's diverse communities into your podcast. How do you see yourself doing that?
That's an excellent question. I have a couple different ideas. So to answer the question, yes, I want to get involved directly with political commentary. That is something that I feel very drawn to. That's a lot of what I watch on YouTube, is just following what the hell is going on with our country. Like, I try to pay attention to my state because that's most relevant to me directly day to day. But at the same time, on a national level, if we're crumbling, then on a state level, there's only so much we can do. So I do try to just stay up and up with politics in general. That being said, politics turns most people off,
yeah,
especially nowadays. So I'm trying to figure out a way to create content that is viewable at a daily moment, but also gives you some news. So I haven't done this elevator pitch before, so that's why I'm stumbling over it. Basically, okay. I would like to give videos that are palatable, where they're just kind of fun and lighthearted, where if you're having a bad day, you can still put this video on and still get a little bit of news, but not feel bad at the end of it. You know what I mean? So much of politics leaves you feeling dirty afterwards.
Yeah.
But that being said, I do love deep dives. I've really enjoyed diving in. Some of my podcasts or some of my episodes are like over an hour. And that's just me reading different articles that I find online that I don't think got enough publication or got enough viewership. So I try to bring them to light. And then I just give commentary on it. Which I enjoy, but I've found that it's not for everyone. So I want to find a way to water that down in a way, still giving facts, still giving relevant bits, but giving it in a way that people can relate to. So what I've thought of is I want to focus on different Maine-based businesses, and I'm probably going to have a video coming out soon. So I found 50 different Maine-based businesses, and I have letters written up to them. I need to get the postage and the envelopes, but I'm going to send out these letters. And it's just saying, like, hey, I'm an up-inspiring YouTube channel, and I would like to sponsor you, or I would like if you guys could sponsor me, either with some free merchandise and then I review it on my channel, or possibly me going to your area and filming on your farm or filming at your business and doing interviews that way. And then while I'm doing those interviews with real people, sprinkling in relevant bits of news about, okay, how much does electricity cost for a job like this? Okay, well, how has X, Y, and Z with the electric grid affected you? And then get into the electricity grid news that way, while also promoting this Maine-based company.
Absolutely.
Trying to make it more palatable. I don't know if that made sense. I didn't practice that before.
I could really understand what you mean. I had an idea like that before, called Look Around Mississippi, where I wanted to go interview different small business owners and ask them about their journey, but it's like, nah, nobody want to watch that. But really, it was just me.
I think people would.
Yeah, they would. And they need it. The community needs that kind of advertisement, because there are a lot of people who don't know that these shops exist.
Yeah. And I mean, nowadays, after COVID, you're almost intimidated to go into a new shop you've never been into.
Yep.
I don't know if that's just me.
No, it's me too, man. I Google it and see like what kind of customer shop there or what it looks like on the inside. Restaurants too.
Yeah.
I try to see, get a feel of the atmosphere before I go. Because I'm so like, okay, if I go in here, everybody's gonna turn around, hey, get out of here. So, but this is a little anxiety. But anyway, I totally agree, man. You need that, and we need that in Mississippi. So, what are your goals for the future of your channel and podcast, and how do you see them evolving over time?
I would like to see a growing a following here in Maine, so that way we have an independent voice that could compete with the narrative. Because something else that got me into YouTube is that George Soros, his backed nonprofit, bought out 130 plus news media sites here in Maine, from small newspapers, local newspapers, to the large newspapers. Therefore, they're all going to be kind of washed in the same fashion. And when I found that out, I was like, wow, like, we're already hearing only really one side of a story. And I do kind of believe that there's three sides to a story. There's
absolutely
one side, there's the flip side, and then there's the truth. And so if we're not looking in multiple areas to get information, and if we're not getting even slightly opposing viewpoints, then there's something wrong. If you're going to the newspapers, regardless of where and what demographic you're looking at across the state, and they're all saying exactly the same thing or nearly the same thing, is that really news? Because sometimes I've gone to dig deeper into these news articles here in Maine that are like 300 words. And I'm like, okay, how can I read about that on camera? Because that's like a 3-second thing. Then I go to dig deeper into it, and it's all these different publications, also around 300 words, maybe 500. And then it's all giving the same information. And I'm like, this doesn't feel like news. Mm. This doesn't feel like what it should be. I always grew up kind of envious of investigative journalists, because they got to go out and explore and like sleuth around, and they got to write. Writing is my biggest passion. I love writing. And so I think that also helps answer the question from earlier about storytelling, because I love writing, so helping navigate that. But just, wow, now I threw myself off. I lost my train of thought.
Well, you were mentioning about like news outlets just running the same stories, period. And you were used to
just having having an independent thought where, yes, I'm a human being, so I am biased. But at that same note, I want to give a perspective that resonates with other blue-collar Maine workers, where they can say, you know what, I don't agree 100% with what Drew says, but he always brings to light these different things. And if he's wrong, it was only really because this or this or that, or we're not supposed to agree. Like, you and I, Denny, we agree on a lot of things, but if we start agreeing on 100% of some of anything, like, one of us is lying. Like, that's, and it's not a bad thing. Like, we don't need to agree 100% on anything. And even married couples don't agree 100% on everything. And I think that's okay. I think if it was, then one of them has either lost their soul and is a robot, or one of them is lying.
Yeah, you're talking about some submissiveness.
And the wrong kind of submissiveness. I think there's a right and a wrong kind.
Yes. Wow. If my spouse agreed with me 100% all the time, I would think, okay, where's the other guy? Because this is too easy.
Either that, or like, what did I do wrong? Like, if this person is agreeing with me all the time, 100% of the time, like, did I break them? Like, yeah. Are they? Like, there should be, no, I feel like Italian tonight, not Chinese. Okay, cool. Like, let's do that. But if it's, no, Chinese, good. And it's like, well, I don't know.
Yeah, whatever you decide. Huh?
Yeah.
That's no fun. That's no fun at all. All right. Man, Drew, our conversation comes to a close. We're left with a deep appreciation for the state of Maine and the power of independent media. I hope one day you get to do some investigative journalism. I definitely want to do it. I'm just terrified. yeah, full transparency. But, Drew, thank you for sharing your journey and your insights with us and for bringing the stories of Maine to a wider audience through your unique lens. And to our listeners, be sure to check out Drew's YouTube channel and podcast for a captivating blend of personal narratives, local politics, and the beauty of Maine. My co-host Pagosi from the Pod Squad is trying to help me incorporate your YouTube channel into our advertisement. So we got something special for you coming, Drew. Shout out to Pagosi, man.
Awesome.
You're a gem.
Yeah, Pagosi.
Yeah, we appreciate you for that. So until next time, guys, keep exploring. Definitely keep asking the right questions. Keep questioning. Keep questioning your politics. Keep demanding better from your politicians. And keep enjoying the rich tapestry of stories that make up our world. Drew, again, man.
Amen.
If we didn't cover anything you wanted to speak about, please do so right now. I know how we can get caught up in a conversation and just, you know, kind of leave out all the other stuff.
Yeah, no, I just want to say thank you. As always, Denny, it's been a pleasure, and it's always really easy talking with you. And I look forward to listening more to this podcast. Before I was on it, I listened to a few of your different episodes, and I was like, wow, okay, I feel like I made a really good decision here. And then I got really nervous because I was like, this is really professional and I don't feel I'm on that league yet. But here I am, so hopefully it goes over well.
It does, man.
You have been really awesome to talk with and hang out with.
Hey, man, I appreciate that, Drew. What I tell most podcasters is that I've been doing this for 10 years.
Nice. Yeah, so, that's a long time.
Yeah, it's a long time to find your groove. And
yeah, absolutely.
So that's all that is, man. I found my groove, and this is it.
I look forward to getting there myself.
Yes, sir. You will, man. I see it happening. Like I said, based off perceptions, I had no idea. Like, you could do all these wonderful things, chop trees, ski, and blue collar, and a podcaster. You're incredible, man, and keep doing that.
Thank you.
Where can our listeners connect with you? Oh, I'm sorry.
Nope. I apologize.
Yeah, where can our listeners connect with you online and check out your content?
So andrewhoagland.com is my website, Andrew, and then Hoagland, Hoagland.com. That has all of my YouTubes and my socials there, or on YouTube right at Drew Hoagland. Again, Drew, DrewHoagland. Drew Hoagland on YouTube or andrewhoagland.com.
All right. Listeners, just in case you didn't get those links, no worries. I will have them in the description of this episode and in the show notes. So all you guys have to do is just click the links and connect. It's that simple. I know it's early. You probably didn't get those links. You probably sleep, you know, drinking your cup of Joe or something. I got you. Don't worry. Drew, thank you again, man. It's been a pleasure.
Yeah, thank you, Deanie. You have a great day.
You too. Bye.
Bye.
Hey there. Do you love podcasts? Are you having difficulty finding the right ones to listen to? Is it frustrating when you're trying to pick that show? You know, the one where everyone must collectively agree on? Like finding a good movie or TV show to watch, do you look for the most jam-packed entertainment that's possible to find in a single episode every week? Then search no more. And welcome to J&J Production Studios. It's our business to provide the best entertainment and information available for you. Whether you're sitting in that comfy chair with your favorite snack and beverage listening live each week, or downloading your favorite show episodes to take with you on the go while you're at work, exercising, or even just to play at night for you to fall asleep to. There's something for everyone, no matter what size, shape, or age you are. Visit www.linktree.com/J_J Production Studios to find all the streaming services where our podcast shows can be found. You can also connect with us on your favorite social media platforms, including Facebook and Twitter. You can join our public Discord server and chat directly with us. But wait, there's more. You can subscribe to our official YouTube channel and be notified every time a new show is broadcast. Wish you could have some studio souvenirs or collectibles? Guess what? You can! Visit the official store where you can purchase items featuring your favorite podcast and show hosts. Would you like to help support us? You can do that by getting your very own exclusive membership on our Patreon account. All proceeds go to help us upgrade our shows, which will only enhance the entertainment provided to you. Thank you so much. We're excited to have you as an audience. Your love and support are always appreciated. We'll see you soon.
Hey, what's going on, guys? Be sure to tune in today. All sorts of fun and excitement that will keep you entertained wherever you are. J&J Production Studios, your number one home for entertainment. Thank you, my Vigilantes family, as always, for checking out my podcast over here at Vigilantes Radio Live. All episodes are available for free download, and you can grab it from either Spreaker.com/Only One Media Group, Spotify, CastBox, iHeartRadio, iTunes, YouTube, the app Podcast Addict, or over at our website, which again is onlyonemediagroup.com. And that goes for every single show that we've ever aired. If you like to request music or send something for me to play, email it to vradio@onlyonemediagroup.com. That is V as in Victor. And here's my disclaimer. We are genre free. We do not judge, and we absolutely do not base our opinions on hearsay, but facts alone. And actually, scratch all of that, because all of my opinions are always right. That's the bottom line. This is my show, so deal with it. Just kidding. On behalf of myself, Denny, I appreciate all you guys for tuning in, either afterwards or live with us. Spread the word, because sharing is caring. We stepped up our game just for you guys and our guests to make sure that you have the best experience here on our show. Be sure to connect with me on Facebook, Twitter, Instagram, Tumblr, Snapchat, TikTok, at all social media sites, as well as Spreaker, YouTube. We always follow back. Okay, well, just remember to put yourself into everything that you do and never stop investing in yourself. Peace, love, grilled cheese, and talk with you later.
You are now listening to Vigilantes Radio. The people's choice for quality interviews, art, music, and hot topics. Hosted by Demetrius Whodini-Blak Reynolds of the duo No Longer the Hero. All episodes of this podcast are available for free download at www.onlyonemediagroup.com. This is a Seventh Sign Regime, Rebirth Worldwide Syndicate exclusive.